Welcome everybody to attend this interesting session. First of all, I would like to thank the European College of Sports Science for this invitation to participate in this virtual Congress. And also, of course, thank you the technicians who are making this video conference possible. So welcome to everybody and thank you for your attendance. I am Rafael Timón Andrada, professor in the Sports Science Faculty from the University of Extremadura in Spain. I will act as chairman and then a speaker in this invited session. The title of this virtual session is Epoxy Exercise, Performance and Health Benefits. To talk about this hot topic, we are joined by two relevant researchers and professors in this scientific area. Firstly, I'm going to introduce Professor Belén Feriche. She's a full professor in the Sports Science Faculty in Granada from Spain. And secondly, although not less important, Professor Antonio Usai from University of Ljubljana, Professor of Ljubljana from Slovenia. So I think this is an interesting, amazing session. In this way, traditionally, the altitude training has been used by athletes to increase the physical performance. Nowadays, the epoxy training has become available to more professionals, coaches and athletes through normobaric epoxy chamber, who try to achieve effective muscular, hematological and not hematological adaptations. In this way, this adaptation can be beneficial for both athletes and not at least. So, in the first part of this session, the speaker, Ms. Belén Feriche and Mr. Antonio Usai are going to speak about the performance benefits. And finally, I'm going to talk about the health benefits. So, it's the time to the full professor. This is a big applause for her, and this is the moment for Ms. Belén Feriche. Thank you very much. Enjoy this presentation.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Timón. Good morning. My name is Belén Feriche. I come from the University of Granada in Spain. Thank you very much for this invitation. It is an honor for me to be here at this 25th anniversary of the European Congress of Sport Science. I am going to share with you my experience in strength training under epoxic condition as part of this invited session on epoxic exercise. Altitude training frequently is part of elite sport people physical training. Hypoxia has been used mostly by endurance athletes. However, other kinds of adaptation exist and are responsible of the change in performance of our athletes. In this context, the study of the weight training is of paramount importance due to the role that resistance training has in any sport. From this point of view, research is focused on to know the altitude effect on strength, causes, and how to train to the best results. Over the next few minutes, I will address issues in relation to muscle strength and power training. Let's start with the explosive movements. It could be expected that for the same inspired oxygen fraction, the physiological response is similar in natural hypoxia compared to normobaric hypoxia. However, as recently has been stated by Millet et al., barometric pressure may independently exert an important influence, especially in cardiovascular and ventilatory responses. In addition, the drop of the barometric pressure also produces a reduction in their density, which have a big influence in sport movements performed at high velocity. So, improvement in high speed, cycling, sprints, jumping, or throwing are clearly described in literature. But in the case of throwing or kicking an object, the resistance also could affect the path and the spin, which must be taken into account in sports such as soccer, tennis, and so on. So There are physiological mechanisms that support the hypothesis that hypoxia can improve performance in explosive action and that these benefits could be delivered at real altitude by the action of the addition of the physical ones. Taken all together, and despite the negative effect displayed in some studies conducted above the 3,500 meters above sea level, it has been suggested that the air density reduction and or the increase in the anaerobic metabolisms described under hypoxia condition can influence the metabolic cost, increase the fast fiber recruitment and the spinal excitability, improving the takeoff velocity and the muscle power output, which may explain the results that we have seen in competition. However, altitude also have this effect during isolated explosive movement, commonly used in resistance running session. This change in performance is also described in literature. For instance, in this table are displayed a big part of the studies focused on explosive actions conducted under acute moderate hypoxia. In the last column, black pieces represent a positive hypoxia effect on the force-velocity relationship variables. Two studies used or compared simulated hypoxia, and in both occasions, no hypoxia effect were observed. This does not mean that we questioned the physiological function of isolated hypoxia and fast strength, but these results indicate that at least an additional effect between the environmental and the physiological factors of the hypoxia happened in favor of hyperbaric hypoxia. The speed of the competition action in sprints, for example, is much higher than the reached in the training exercise commonly analyzed. Squat jump, contra movement jump, and even bench press, squat, and so on. However, it is possible that although at lower intensity, the altitude effect occurs at real but not at simulated altitude, affecting the performance and probably the training effect when longer periods are used. A common characteristic observed in all these studies conducted at natural altitude is the immediately increase of the velocity at which the participant can lift a load. This indicates that at the same absolute load, the participants must be able to develop more power in altitude compared to normoxia due to the shift in the force-velocity relationship. For instance, in this study, one of the first, the complete force-velocity curve in explosive bench press was compared between two groups of common sport participants in normoxia and hyperbaric hypoxia or normobaric hypoxia. At altitude, it was observed an increment of the absolute load at which the maximum power was located, joined to an increase in the one repetition maximum. For this reason, the maximal power and the percentage of the one maximum repetition linked to it did not change. The power improvement was linked to an increase in the peak velocity of the complete force velocity curve and only of the mean velocity from the middle part of the curve. This is because the braking phase with light weight is larger as less weight is lifted. No change in the normobaric hypoxia group was observed at any time. In a similar way, the acute ascent to Sierra Nevada of 17 elite swimmers from the Slovenian national team also displayed an increase in the maximal power in overload squat jump. This change was caused by an improvement in the maximal theoretical velocity at which lower limbs can extend, with no significant change for the maximal theoretical force. Then, it seems clear that acute exposition to a moderate altitude not simulate improve the force velocity relationships toward a more explosive profile. But this is under acute exposition. So the question is what happens after longer stays. Obviously, it will depend on what the athletes do. The same 17 swimmers of the Slovenian national team were tested before 24 hours after the arrival to the High Performance Center of Sierra Nevada, after 3 weeks of training and after the return to Slovenia. In this study, no instructions were given on when to train. Swimmers were monitored during the study period, resulting in 3 weeks of concurrent training. It can be seen here the acute effect of altitude on the velocity, which remains increased through the stay but disappears after the return to sea level. In this, this is translated in a slope change of about 10%. Therefore, it could be said that 3 weeks of concurrent training do not affect the force velocity profile the swimmers have before going up, but it does not make it worse either. Additionally, the data were compared with a control group that performed the same training in normoxia condition. Both measurements were done in normoxia before and after the training period. As in altitude, normoxia groups does not reflect difference in peak velocity at different overloads. However, the start performance and the horizontal takeoff velocity from the starting block were less affected after the altitude came compared to the control group. This study also analyzed other neuromuscular component variables before and after the training period, the excitability of the alpha motor neuron and the neuromuscular activation during a maximal voluntary contraction. New changes of interest were found, and while a bit increment of the maximal voluntary contraction in an isometric way was observed at altitude, no difference with respect to the control group was achieved. The age reflex showed a significant acute effect and increased the excitability about 40% during the first hour after the ascent, although after 12 hours at altitude, no differences were observed with respect to the pre-ascent values. So we still must to clarify additional questions, such as how does the oriented muscle power training could affect the results at altitude, and also considering the age reflex increasing after sudden ascent, it will be interesting to consider intermittent versus traditional hypoxia training strategies on muscle power. Morales Artacho et al. Compared the living load running high and living load running low strategy on the muscle power and structure after an oriented muscle power training mesocycle of 4 weeks. They used a fixed mean propulsive velocity of 1 meter per second to adjust the training load in the contra-movement jump, which was the main exercise of the training session. Results displayed trivial region-specific muscle thickness change in both groups. Maximal isometric strength was also increased in both groups with no difference by altitude training, while the neuromuscular activation was also maintained. The force velocity profile was also measured in this study. Result displayed a toning effect on the maximal theoretical force and on the maximal power. Additionally, the maximal power development was a bit greater in the hypoxia group due to that this group was able to keep a stable the velocity throughout the training period. It is important to consider that a stable velocity was used throughout all the training period, of course. In this case, this research compared the effect of the classic strategy of living high, training high versus living low, training low. For this, 25 elite judokas were divided in two groups and performed a special mesocycle of 3 weeks at which the power development was the training objective. At the top of the slide can be seen the design usage. The subjects were assessed just before the training period, just at the end, and 1 and 2 weeks after the training period. The training routine includes 3 muscle power training sessions per week using 1.2 meters per second of the mean propulsive velocity as the reference of the training load. Pre and post evaluation include anthropometry, technique, neuromuscular, and force velocity profile assessment through a progressive loaded test with contra-movement jump. So, in this slide are shown the peak velocity developed during the force velocity test. In all cases, both groups improved their performance, however, not at the same time. For this, the interaction per group moment. The altitude group reached the maximal performance early in time compared to normoxia. It can be seen better in this figure. So during the three, at the end of the three oriented training weeks at moderate altitude, seems to induce higher magnitude of positive change in explosive leg extension capacity, which can be reached earlier in comparison to the same training in nausea. Then, in a second place, let's see what's happened with the hypertrophic training under hypoxia condition. This same literature establishes an association between the production of metabolites and some ions, particularly lactate, inorganic phosphorum, protons, or calcium, and activation of several mechanisms related to the muscle mass growth. Then, exercise in hypoxia is associated with a greater muscle desaturation, which leads to an increase in the anaerobic metabolism and therefore a magnification in the production of the metabolites. Among the naming mechanisms, the recruitment of additional motor units especially affects to the high stimulation threshold 1, with the aim to ensure the optimal motor function in an unfavorable context. This motor profile is more susceptible to hypertrophy, but also with the right orientation can improve the speed and execution, as we have mentioned before. In any case, if the number of muscle fibers stimulated during a training session increases, a large portion of the muscle may respond and adapt to the stress of the training. However, the results of the available studies are not conclusive, and data from the acute or chronic natural altitude are scarce. Following this reasoning, several studies have been conducted at simulated and natural altitude. In this review table, no many black marks are observed except in one case. This section is very interesting because the use of light loads during the training period. But this kind of load were also used in the Friedman studies. So the difference in the result between them may be due to the methodology used, repetition to fail versus fixed repetition. Then, from a general point of view, considering the last two published reviews on this topic, exist large discrepancies among the procedures used in the published study that limit the application of the results. The reviews conclude that resistance training under hypoxia condition improve the strength and muscle mass in a similar way than normoxia, despite the potential effect that the hypoxia has. Other studies have been conducted after these reviews. In this case, Innes et al. Analyzed the effect of 7 weeks of training in severe intermittent hypoxia, performing 3 sessions a week with moderate heavy loads. At the end of the training period, they recorded an additional 5.4% increase in the maximal dynamic strength in homeobaric hypoxia compared to placebo group. However, this change was not followed by change in body composition, which was justified by neuromuscular adaptation. However, no specific anthropometric studies was performed in this study. In this case, the effect of moderate hypoxia on the outcome of 8 weeks of high-intensity resistant circuit training has also been studied. Neuromuscular, body composition, muscle architecture, strength, and blood tests were determined before and after. Both groups slightly improved maximal and explosive strength, limb mass, vasolateral thickness, and H and M wave amplitude, with no difference between groups. Authors did not find any effect in the biochemical variable measure. In this old recent study, authors determined whether manipulating interserver periods 1 minute compared to 3 minutes during a resistant running session in middle acute simulated hypoxia impacts on physiological related to muscle hypertrophy. Shortener intercept rest period significantly increased muscle activation and perceived exertion in the later sets of the resistance. But again, contrary to the expectation, hypoxia did not augment the physiological or perceptual responses. We can see in the slide correspond to difference among sets, not among condition, not between condition. Even blood lactate was similar. As no differences in muscle oxygen were observed between hypoxia and normoxia trials, it was not surprising that the magnitude of anaerobic metabolism, heart rate, or even muscle activation were not different. the low altitude or the lack of the use of multi-joint exercises could justify the result. However, when two traditional full body training sessions were compared at more than a natural altitude with respect to normal condition, the obtained results were similar. Natural altitude is considered as more severe stimulus compared to the same simulated hypoxia, and in this case, full body session includes 6 functional exercises. Performance, RPE, and maximal blood lactate concentration were similar between conditions. A higher buffer activity was also detected at altitude. Other metabolic hormones variables were also evaluated in this study. Altitude did not affect the responses in circulating calcium, cortisol, or testosterone, which was similar to normoxia condition. The tendency to reduce the growth hormone during the hypoxia recovery can be consistent with the clear but unexpected lower inorganic phosphorum in the recovery at this condition. Due to the long recovery time uses, the cardiovascular and respiratory effect of the acute altitude developed some metabolic alkalosis and increased the cardiac output during the first hours, improving the blood perfusion and oxygenation to the muscle. This can reduce the time needed to phosphocreatine restoration. Far above, because it's not my specialty, we want to comment on the new agents which are currently being incorporated into the analysis of the muscle differentiation process. For example, microRNAs. Particularly, the 378 has been the only one analysis in strength sessions in humans. Its action is based on the silencing of a transcription factor allowing the myogenic differentiation be expressed. Therefore, it could be assumed that the higher level of 378 is, the greater muscle differentiation will be. Under the commented condition of the studies, this 378 did not show difference neither by exercise nor by condition. This microRNA is not specifically expressed in the muscle. This may produce that it is a relevant biomarker in the global response to exercise in clinical or sedentary population, but it could have some limitation when it is applied to a trained population. Almost the variability between subjects could reveal the presences of responding and non-responding participants. The interaction between metabolic stress and iron flow during exercise under hypoxia condition also involve inflammatory responses. The interaction between this response and the hypoxia muscle development is being studied. Particularly, the interleukin-6 is currently presented as a protein related to the glucose metabolism and with an important role in the regulation of the muscle growth due to it is involved in the activation of the mTOR pathway. In the commented study, in interleukin-6 displayed a larger, although delayed, increase in hypoxia compared to normoxia. This delay favors and extends the release of interleukin-6, favoring its role in muscle remodeling after exercise. The effect that hypoxia has on the increment of reactive oxygen species and the buffer activity already described are among possible causes of this behavior due to its relationship with glucose to conclude, the available results are not conclusive about the hypoxia potentiation effect on muscle hypertrophy or strength by resistance training. Nevertheless, preliminary results at molecular level suggest that the functional effect of hypoxia on muscle growing might be through the activation of satellite cell-dependent myogenesis rather than improving the protein balance. However, the mechanisms involved in this process are largely unknown. For this reason, controlled studies are needed to determine a stronger conclusion that indicate how to take advantage of the potential use of hypoxia in this context. So this is all. Thank you very much for your attention.
So I have Sorry. Yes. Thank you. Thank you
for that. You know.
Thank you for your nice presentation. And this is a time for discussion. So this is a very interesting topic. You told us that there are differences between the type of hypoxia, if the normal body hypoxia or hypobaric hypoxia. So could be said that there are differences between the type of hypoxia and the effect of strength training?
Yes. This happens especially in exercises that are performed at a high speed, as correspond to the training and muscle power of explosive strength, for instance. This is mainly because the addition in the case of the real altitude or the density of the air decreases in approximate a proportion of 3% for every 300 meter of ascent. We could have an idea at a moderate altitude in Sierra Nevada, for instance, 2,320 meters above sea level. The density of the air is reduced almost at 20% if we have 20 degrees of temperature and low humidity. This made possible to cause a change in speed in a proportion almost linear with increasing speed in low speed movement and quadratic, of course, in the case of high speeds. Although there is an important difference between the speed of a sprint, no, that may be 11 meters per second, and a contra movement jump that in the best of the case, no, may be near, no, to 3 meters per second, the effect of a lower aerodynamic position, in additional way to the physiological change, of course, no, made that this change happened, although it is of a small magnitude. Another way, in the case of hypertrophy training, the velocity in execution is not important. No? And apparently, the local effect of hypoxia is similar in both types of hypoxia.
Okay, perfect. And so, it's important so to adapt training routine when training in hypoxia compared to normoxia.
This is a very interesting question because it's the first thing that all the athletes ask us, no, when they are going to prepare in a stand in altitude condition. Again, that depends on what are they going to do and the kind of hypoxia they are going to use. No, in the case of natural altitude, as soon as they are standing, it is possible to observe a displacement, a shift, no, to the right of the four velocity profile, asking an increase in the turning load to develop the same power. In the case that at least prefers to keep the same load, it will be recommended to emphasize velocity to take advantage of the lightening of the impact of the load. The main difference that we have observed in this load displacement is around 7%. So monitoring of lifting velocity or the application of the velocity-based training methodology is especially useful in these cases. However, through the 3 weeks of training, the evolution of the load slows down and is practically equal to what we will have with the same training carried out in normoxia. So the procedure is different, but at the end, after the end of the 3 weeks, the result is very similar regarding to the load that the athletes are using to train. No? However, when the muscle power is measured, the result in the altitude group is normally is bigger, and the maximal performance is reached before in time compared to the normoxia group. In relation to hypertrophy training, there are no reason to make us think that the training load must be modified. Researchers agree that intercept recovery should be short, more closer to 60 seconds than to 19 seconds. Longer intercept set recovery seem to dilute the effect of an additional that can add the hypoxia condition.
Okay, thank you for this interesting information for athletes and for coaches. So I don't know if Professor Usai has any question or
So I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with power and strength training with hypoxia, but my question is, what's happened when subjects go to hypoxic conditions in relation to activation of central nervous system? You found, if I remember well, that H reflex didn't change. So why you didn't try to answer your question in the brain? Because in hypoxia, brain is probably activated more, then also norepinephrine, epinephrine is increasing, and maybe it's there some effect of altitude training related to power. But further, when the subject comes down from hypoxia, I didn't realize what is really happened. It's this effect which should be happened at altitude continue to be detected or not?
Okay, the comment that you have making is very important, because it is something that needs to be further research, no, in this topic. If you remember, practically all the research I have consulted and at which I have participated with colleagues of you, no, from Slovenia, mm-hmm. Professor Volko, they have overall measured the muscle activation and also the H reflex. No, the H reflex has a very interesting behavior, because the neuromuscular excitability increased a lot in natural altitude, but only during the first hour of exposition. But after 10-12 hours, the values return to the subject had previous descent. And they are keeping again, no, 3 weeks later, and including when they return to the sea level, no. So from a peripheric point of view, we have not observed very interesting change. Mm-hmm. However, if we used intermittent hypoxic exposition, maybe that this change in the H reflex could improve, you know, in this way the result, no, about the peripheral role that the neuromuscular excitability produces regarding to the effect of the training period. However, I agree with you again that we need to learn much more about that, and the central drive output and the control, no, of really what's happened, no, in the nervous system must to be deeply studied, no? And we are trying to improve this knowledge in the health sanitary, the sanitary condition allowed us to do this very soonly, using magnetic stimulation, no? And mm-hmm. to see if there is very change overall in the threshold, potential threshold that the subject could develop regarding to the hypoxia exposition and all exercise performing during several weeks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you both for your opinion and for your interesting answer. So it's no time for too much. So we are going to move to the second presentation. The second presentation is about the non-hematological adaptation to altitude training. Will be given by Professor Anton Jusaj from the University of Ljubljana in Slovenia. Thank you. This is your time, Professor Anton.
Thank you for this presentation for me. Before I start, I would like to thank you, Professor Rafael Timon Andrada, for kindly invitation to this session. So I would like today to represent some of non-hematological adaptation to endurance training. So as you know very well, that altitude training, one training unit is consisted of catabolic phase related to endurance training, usually at lower altitude, and then of sleeping interval of anabolic phase.
Sorry that I interrupt you. We cannot see your slides, your presentation.
Okay.
Just a moment, please, Anton, because we don't have your presentation. Please, you can.
Yes. No, it's fine.
Perfect. Okay, thank you.
I will start again with second slide. So altitude training characteristics. One training unit is consisted of catabolic phase, usually of endurance training at low altitude, and of anabolic phase of living, sleeping at higher altitudes. So both of these phases are consisted, for example, catabolic phase by training dose and training hypoxic dose, and living or anabolic phase by nocturnal hypoxic dose. And all these three doses are characterized by their volume and intensity. So all these characteristics made adaptations, which occurs during altitude training or during endurance training at low altitude. So all you are familiar with this adaptation. So I would like to point out only some specific things. First of these is non-hematological adaptation to hypoxic exposure. These are usually characteristic by increase of ventilation and increase of heart rate. But if we compare these alterations by alterations during submaximal exercise at low altitude, we saw that ventilation heart rate decreases by endurance training. So question is whether alterations during hypoxic exposure are similarly valid as adaptation during submaximal exercise if we like to understand competition results during low exercise altitude. And again, hypoxic exposure increase concentration of erythrocyte, hemoglobin, and hematocrit values. But if we saw hematological adaptations usually, which usually occur during endurance training at low altitude, there is usually only increase in plasma volume. So there are differentiation in these adaptations. So question is how we to understand this and how we follow this during research exercising. So the problem is that typical altitude training increase hematological adaptations, which are very strong adaptations, but this adaptation may be masked influence of non-hematological adaptations. So to resolve this problem, we are trying to prevent hematological adaptations by using lower nocturnal hypoxic dose of only 10 hours and only 3 weeks of, instead of recommendation, 4 weeks of training interval. So by this, we hope, we have hoped that we will prevent hematological adaptations, and this gives us possibility to observe more specifically non-hematological adaptations. So in our first experiment, we used national cross-country ski team of 16 subjects in the second preparatory period, some July, August. And these skiers, increase training volume during this altitude training and nocturnal hypoxic dose. So what I mean with living high, this is 1500 meters of terrestrial altitude plus normal baric hypoxia in hypoxic rooms. So by moderate altitude used by training, I mean 1000 to 1500 meters of altitude training where training program was realized. And living at moderate altitude was living at 1500 meters of terrestrial altitude. So we testing these subjects by using maximal cross-country ski roller trial, by measuring gas exchange, heart rate, then lactate concentration, and acid-base status. Additionally, we measure this subject also by submaximal laboratory test on cyclergometer. Cyclergometer was used because these subjects also trained by using cyclergometers, cycling in this period of training. So this test was consisted of 100 watts exercise with 10 minutes 10 minutes warm up, then 3 minutes hypoxic interval, 3 minutes normoxic interval, and 3.5 watts per kilogram of exercise. We measured the same characteristics with additional of near infrared spectroscopy by using Neuro 200 for Hamamatsu photonics. So what our results shows that we reach these goals related to hematological parameters. Hematological parameters didn't change in these settings. So red blood cells, hemoglobin, hematocrit, and erythropoietin didn't change. So we can observe now non-hematological changes. Velocity during trials were different between both groups, but we can observe now here that there is clear tendency of decreasing ski roller running velocity, probably by enhancement of or accumulated or fatigue. After that, when they stop with altitude training and return to sea level training and with reduced volume of training, we can see significant increase of performance, but only if living moderate, train moderate group. Living high train moderate group didn't influence significantly their performance. So tapering may be important training tool for enhanced performance also after altitude training. But our results during submaximal testing show also some other interesting things. Ventilation increased through all this test only in living high train moderate group because of hypoxic response. Similarly, or consequently, pH of blood increased during 100 watts of exercise due to increased ventilation, but when subject changed to 3.5 watts per kilogram, the opposite effects, the increase of pH was significant in other group, so in living train and moderate trained group. So decided to the metabolic effect. When we observe oxygenation of muscle, the decrease of deoxygenated hemoglobin, you can see here in all interval of exercise maximal, but also total hemoglobin decreased, resulting in increase of tissue oxygenated index. So this happened in live moderate, train moderate group. When we observed living high and train moderate group, there were not such as alterations, so alterations were not significant in any of the parameters of muscle oxygenation. Also, total hemoglobin didn't change. So from this first part, we can conclude that neither of both training methods affect differently performance, but accumulated fatigue, which is usually presented in such kind of endurance training, altitude endurance training, is important importantly influenced on performance. So tapering, especially if we use live moderate, train moderate training, may be very important. But when we ask ourselves whether differences by using live moderate, train moderate training support enhancement of endurance training performance at low altitude, then we have two answers. First is no. If we observe ventilation changes, then we didn't find any relationship with performance. This answer can be yes if we observe increase of pH during 3.5 watt exercise, and if we observe muscle deoxygenated hemoglobin and total hemoglobin in relation to performance. So these results are valid only in conditions of non-hematological adaptations, but to ascertain probably mechanisms related to these changes, we need additional data. So we have need additional data, so we perform a second study, and now we normalized exercise, all of subjects performance 1 hour continuous exercise every training day with highest possible intensity of which can they perform on this particular day. And we have now three groups of subjects. I will represent a later characteristic of these groups to answer whether and how these changes which we have obtained during the first part are also presented here in the second part. So we have, as I told before, 10 subjects who live low and train low, 11 subjects who train at high altitude and living at more moderate altitude. You have here representations, what is the meaning of moderate and high, same as before, and 10 subjects who live high and train moderate. Standardization conditions was related to similar age, similar training during pre-experimental period. So they are all students of sports science, and they are the same programs. And same training except individual intensity, and similar also nutrition regime in both conditions of high altitude training. So what we have found, again, there were no significant change in concentration of erythrocyte, hemoglobin, and hematocrit. But now we have asked ourselves, are these meaning no alterations? So concentrations of these parameters were not changed. But if plasma volume was changed, then this is correct. No hematological adaptation occurred. But if plasma volume increased, and we haven't possibility to measure volume of plasma, then the answers were different. In this case, blood volume increased. So this means that mass of hemoglobin should increase too, and capacity of oxygen increased in this case. And additionally, when blood volume increased, stroke volume may also increase by Frank Starling law. So we believe that we have not found found this kind of adaptations, and that our blood volume was not changed. But we have now answered this question. So if we continue continuing to training those, as I represented at the beginning, we can see that those who trained at low altitude has highest power output during training. But if we obtain time course changes, then up to 10 training sessions, there was nothing dramatically happened during this training. After that, performance increase up to 20 sessions, and then starts to decrease because of accumulated fatigue. The second group who live high and train moderate, so these subjects train at 1500 meter. So it is normally to expect that power output during training was a little bit lower, but again, performance estimated from intensity of exercise, the training exercise, was not changed. And after 16 training sessions, there is again a little bit decrease in performance due to accumulated fatigue. And finally, those who train in more hypoxic conditions, so 1500 plus normal body hypoxia, shows typical lower performance during beginning, but then there is increase due to acclimatization effect. And in the last part, there is practically no change, no difference between both altitude methods. Nevertheless, when we observed hypoxic dose during training, we didn't observe during those who trained at low altitude, but only those who train, who use altitude training. And we can see that those who train at high altitude have the highest dose of the most significant decrease in saturation of oxygen in their blood. So if we conclude from this training data, we estimated that the highest overall dose was in group of living high and train moderate. But all the three groups has different training overall doses. So by this, we start to explain first 20-kilometer trial on track cyclic simulator, we can see that both altitude training methods increase performance by approximately 18%, and low altitude training method increase only 9%. So increasing is due to lower performance level of this subject at the start. The students, they are not specifically trained for cycling, but nevertheless, there is again a certain relationship with their general doses of their training. But we want to answer, to find some mechanisms. So we follow these subjects before and after altitude training by incremental test, where every step stride duration was 4 minutes and increased by 40 watts up to peak peak power output. This peak power output was used then in a step continuous test to moment of fatigue, and Tmax, to time to maximal access to my to maximal time, was estimated, was follow up. So during this incremental test, we have found decrease of heart rate, typical decrease of heart rate, but only during leave high and train moderate group. This group, leave high and moderate training group, also decreased lactate concentration at the maximal level, but other altitude training group, leave moderate, train high, also decrease lactate concentration, and interesting, leave low, train low group didn't decrease the lactate concentration. So if we summary this data in relation to both threshold, lactate threshold and one set of blood accumulation threshold and maximal power output, we see here that leaving high, train moderate group was the only who increased performance is all three levels marked with red color. Leaving moderate, train high group increased performance only in both thresholds, not in maximal. And leave low, train low group increased performance only in one set of blood lactate accumulation threshold, which is related very well with general dose of training. So finally, when continuous test to fatigue was observed, we can saw that practically all subjects improve except these two outliers who from the normoxis group, for the group who trained and live at low altitude. When we observed ventilation during this test, we saw the significant decrease of ventilation only during living high train moderate group. This group also show clear tendency, not significant data because of this outlier, but clear tendency for decrease of oxygen consumption. No other method shows something like that. And finally, VCO2 decrease again significantly here at leaving high train moderate group and leaving low train low group, indicated that something metabolically happened. So when we go to oxygenation of muscle, then leaving high train moderate group again show the most significant increase of oxygenated hemoglobin post-training, in post-training period. Leaving moderate train high group shows only a tendency for increasing. Now, when observing deoxygenated hemoglobin, we saw only in leaving high train moderate group clear tendency for decrease in total hemoglobin, which may be indicated first typical mechanism. And second was related to leaving moderate train high group, which significantly, this is only a training method which significantly increase total hemoglobin, so perfusion of muscle. So if we put all together, then we conclude that leaving low, training low method from the second study didn't influence significantly aerobic metabolism, in spite CO2 was decreased. Leaving moderate, train moderate group from the first experiment clearly shows no influence on oxygenation hemoglobin, but clearly metabolic effect by decrease deoxygenated hemoglobin and total hemoglobin, which means a decrease of perfusion. If we continue to increase hypoxic dose in the group of living high tremoderate, then we can see for the first time significant influence of aerobic metabolism by decreased ventilation, VCO2, by clear tendency for decreasing oxygen consumption. By increasing oxygenated hemoglobin and clear tendency for decreasing the oxygenated hemoglobin. These characteristics maybe show that enhanced muscle availability is perhaps due to tendency for decrease of oxygen muscle uptake or generally uptake. And this is differently than living moderate trend high group, which maintain aerobic metabolism similarly, but similarly increase oxygenating hemoglobin, but differently increase total hemoglobin, which means that a submaximal exercise intensity, practically all muscle is open, all muscle capillaries are open. And this is not very beneficial for sea level performance. So secondary mechanism, the tendency of enhanced oxygen muscle availability was reached due to enhanced muscle perfusion. So by this, I would like to end, and I would like to thanks for your attention, also in the name of my collaboration of Janez Vodičar, Alia Shegula, and Alexei Dolinshe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for, for this interesting presentation. It's the time for the question. So maybe Professor Felice has any question to Professor Usai, please.
Yes, I have.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Professor Usak, for so very nice presentation. And I have a lot of questions. I don't know if I could make to you all the doubts I have, no? But the first one is in your taking your expertise in this file. For you, what is the most important non-hematological parameter related with performance after, for instance, an endurance altitude or hypoxia training? No, maybe central ventilation, hemodynamic, neural adaptation.
No, it is a combination of all. But the most interesting for me was total hemoglobin. Total hemoglobin is indicator of perfusion of muscle. So during training at low altitude, we always found that total hemoglobin decreased at the same exercise intensity, because also in our case, also heart rate decreased when we have moderate altitude. So all these things comes to improvement, some kind of improvement in economic view of this exercise. But when these subjects transfer to training at high altitude, these characteristics changes. Oxygen consumption, general oxygen consumption, the whole body didn't decrease anymore. And muscle oxygen consumptions, also oxygen consumption, oxygenation remains similarly. And this was reached by enhancement of perfusion, which, according to my understanding, is problematic a little bit, because this characteristic is reached very, very fast. So at low exercise intensity in altitude and intensity, and during performance at low exercise, low altitude, then we have not a reserve from submaximal to maximal intensity to increase perfusion. So this is a characteristic which we are trying to follow again in the future.
Well, very nice. I have another question, Professor Timon, can I do?
Yes, no problem, it's okay, thank you.
Okay, this is a technical curiosity that I have. Huh? This is related with the difference of the two kind of hypoxia simulate compared to natural hypoxia.
Yeah.
In the case of the natural hypoxia, you have different physiological effect just after the ascent to an altitude, and it's called or it's named acute response to altitude. And after the physiological mechanisms are changing, some in one sense, another in the opposite one, no? As the days at altitude is following and is considered chronic altitude. So when we compare, for instance, no, natural with compared to simulate hypoxia, there are some aspects that really worried me, no, regarding to the ventilation, for instance, no, that we have an altitude and alkalosic metabolisms, no, linked to the ventilatory response, mm-hmm. or maybe the hydration that we have also in altitude as response to this alkalosis metabolism and also the dry air. So when I want to compare, maybe, no, one training session of whatever kind of thing, no, a natural altitude and a simulated altitude, maybe this aspect can affect also the physiological response.
I don't think so. That it is. There are differences, but in our case, we do not expect that this can influence largely. Namely, we have only 1500 of natural altitude in this case, and then we have normal baric hypoxia, which simulate altogether not more than 2400 meter of altitude. So it is an interesting question of all. But I do not expect that this kind of changes will be significant here. But anyway, it is interesting to follow up also these parameters. At this moment, I don't know if I have asked of your question. So answer is that I'm personally did not expect very large differences in our case in 3 weeks of training, little changes because we have not also any hematological changes, but ventilation is not also significantly affected by only for subjects who train at high altitude, simulated altitude. But if I have a little bit time to change to answer of one of my questions, which I would like to answer, may I, Professor Timon?
Yes. Yes.
This question is why people at low altitude didn't improve their performance, and they improved their performance, but they did not change any lactate concentrations. So we have asked ourselves, and we do additional experiments or prolonged our experiment in these subjects who trained at low altitude. So when we finish this 3 weeks altitude training for other groups, we ask these subjects who trained at low altitude to continue training for 14 days, additionally for 14 days. And after that, we make the same testing. And we found that those subjects actually decrease lactate concentration to maximal exercise intensities, increase their thresholds. Training effects at low altitude is also effective, but if you use 1 hour exercise, continue exercise, and perform it during the training, you need a little bit more time for the similar effects. So forgive me this time.
Okay, no problem. Thank you. Thank you. Now this is my time to speak. So I'm going to share my presentation. Just a moment, please. Okay, can you see? Okay, perfect. Well, welcome to everybody, and thank you for coming. No, this is my turn. Firstly, I would like to thank the organization in Sevilla, in the European College for Sports Science, inviting me in this virtual congress. So thank you very much. My colleague before had talked about the performance benefits. So now I'm going to talk about the health benefits with hypoxic training. So in this case, like Belén Felice told us before, we can distinguish or differentiate between hyperbaric training and normobaric training. In both cases, we can get different effects and different positive effects for health. Previous studies have concluded that the chronic hypoxia may increase inflammation and cause negative effects on health, like vasoconstrictor activation, hypoxemia, pulmonary hypertension, or arrhythmia. Okay, but according to this study, the Berges et al. Titled hypoxic conditioning as a new therapeutic modality, they explained that the intermittent moderate hypoxia can useful for health because you can alternate the hypoxia with a period, with an oxygenation period, and you can get optimal gain compared to the severe hypoxia. In this way, Millet et al. Sorry, it's not working my... Okay. Millet et al. In this interesting study about therapeutic use of exercise in high hypoxia, promise and limitation, that state that the hypoxic training can be useful to reduce hypertension, decreasing blood pressure and reduction of arterial stiffness. The explanation can be related to the nitric oxide, that the nitric oxide is known that this is an important vasodilator. At the same time, training and high hypoxia can be dealt with obesity. The different studies have said that the hypoxic training can reduce body fat, decrease glucose and total cholesterol, also loss of appetite. In this case, this reduction could have different explanations. The first one is related to an increase in the basal metabolic rate, and the second one is related with the hormonal changes, with an increase in leptin and a decrease in ghrelin. Ghrelin is often called the hunger hormone because it increases food intake. So it's seen that the hypoxia can be useful to reduce obesity. And finally, we can find that the hypoxia can reduce sarcopenia and increase bone mineral density. The moderate hypoxia causes an increase of protein synthesis and an increase in vascular endothelial growth factor involved in a pathway of pot differentiation. So we can find that the hypoxia can be very useful to deal with some illnesses like hypertension, obesity, or aging. In a study from this year, performed by Sakushima et al., have observed in vitro that cells exposed for 6 days to severe hypoxia with a fraction of expired oxygen of 50%, in black, we can see in black the result in the myotube diameter. And in this case, this author found that the myotube diameter was decreased was severe hypoxia. But when they used a moderate hypoxia, like 10% of a fraction of expiratory oxygen, or 15%, that the myocube diameter increased in both cases. So we can find that the hypoxia, severe hypoxia, seems not good for hypertrophy. But in this case, the moderate hypoxia could be positive to increase hypertrophy. In this case, an increase of protein related to differentiation of muscle cells have been observed, for example, an increase in myo-D or increase in myogenin. As can we see in this graph by Kaye et al., we can verify that the hypoxia induced factor 1A play an important role as a transcription factor, activating angiogenesis, activating erythropoiesis, activating glycolysis. But in this case, when we have enough oxygen, the factor, hypoxia factor is degraded, so it's not working. But however, in situation with low oxygen availability, it stabilizes by binding to the histimer and interacting with the hypoxia responsive elements. So this is an important explanation to try to understand like the hypoxia could be useful for health. Until here, I did a brief background about the topic, but now I'm going to show you the most important result obtained by our research group about the hypoxia and health benefits in this effect. So the first presentation or the first research I'm going to show you. This was published in the Frontier and Physiology, and it was titled "Effect of Whole Body Vibration Training Combined with Cycle Hypoxia on Bone Mineral Density in Elderly People." In this case, we did three different groups over 65 years with a total of 30 people. A group is work a whole body vibration in hypoxia, another group work in a whole body vibration in normoxia, and we have a control group. At the beginning, there wasn't any difference between the group. The intervention lasts 18 weeks using 2 days per week, and we use an oscillating vibration platform to train. The people have to do 4 sets by 30 seconds of training with a 1 minute of recovery with this amplitude and this frequency. We differentiate between the group in normoxia who train 21% and a group who train in hypoxia who train 16.1%. According to this training, the result or the main result we can find in this slide. In white, we can observe the level of whole body bone mineral density in control group. In gray, we observe the level of whole body bone mineral density in normoxia group who train whole body vibration, and in black, and in the right side, we can find that the people who train in hypoxia obtain a bigger amount of whole body bone mineral density than the people who train in normoxia. So we can find that the hypoxia training can be used to increase the bone mineral density in seniors. At the same time, Secondly, we propose a new research performing a high intensity resistance training, but with young people. In this study, we use 8 weeks of training at the with a 6 repetition maximum, with a level of hypoxia of 15 fraction of expiry oxygen. We found the same results, because we found, above all, an increase in lean mass, in bone mineral content and bone mineral density. So it's a similar result with a different training, but we found an increase in lean mass, in bone mineral content, and bone mineral density. In this case, it's the same in another study with young people with this protocol, 3 sets to 5 years with an intensity approach to 80% of 1 repetition maximum, in a above sea level of 4,000 meters and 300. We found that this strain and hypoxia increased the percentage of muscle and decreased the percentage of fat. So this is important for health in any population, in seniors or in young people. On the other hand, focusing now on the effects of hypoxia conditioning on obesity, we found that the high intensity interval training in normal body hypoxia leads to greater body fat loss in overweight or obese women than high intensity interval training in normoxia. In this study, obese women who participated voluntarily in the study performed 12 weeks of 56 sections, and they were randomly divided into four groups. A group who trained aerobic interval training in hypoxia, another one is trained in aerobic interval training in normoxia, and third group work like spring interval training and hypoxia, and the fourth group did an spring interval training in normoxia. In this slide, we can find, I showed you the training, the different training or different protocol that we use. On the top, we can find the aerobic interval training in normoxia, aerobic interval training and hypoxia. They did 3 minutes and 90% of peak power, and following of 3 minutes of recovery, and then they repeated this training during 6 repetitions. And at the bottom, we can find other group who train in the spring interval training at 30 seconds, 130% of peak power with 3 minutes of recovery. Also in normoxia and hypoxia. As we can see in this slide, the measurement we carry out in 4 different points. At the beginning, in black, and at the middle of the training, gray, in light gray, in dark gray, at the end, and in the right side, we can find the result at the training. And we can find an important result only in the group who train high hypoxia. We can find differences between the group who train in normoxia, especially at the end and with the training. So we found that the hypoxia again is useful to reduce obesity. So in order to conclude and to give some ideas to take home, according to these results, training under moderate hypoxia could have healthy benefits in different population groups. A slight increase of bone mineral density in senior people have been observed after whole body vibration in hypoxia. Increases in muscle mass and decrease in fat mass has been observed after resistance training and hypoxia. And finally, high intensity interval training under hypoxia condition reduce total and trunk fat max as well as the waist circumferences. So we can conclude that hypoxia is worth to use in the health context. But we have a difficult question, no? Which is the optimal combination of SSI and hypoxia? Because why are there people who respond to some protocol and other one doesn't respond in the same way? So we have to make further investigation, try to find the optimal dose, and try to analyze the intensity, the volume we have to use, or the type of exercise we have to use to get the optimal benefits. So thank you very much for your attention. And this is a photograph of my city in Cáceres. Cáceres is a World Heritage City according to UNESCO. So you have invited to visit us and to be welcome. So thank you very much. I don't know if you have any questions according to my presentation. I'll try to answer them. Thank you. Yes, Belén, Ms. Felice has any question? Thank you very much for.
I would like to know something. Well, congratulations, of course, okay, no, for the presentation. And I would like to know a bit more about the future lines that you have included in your last slide, no? About what is your hypothesis, no? About this. So, what do you think about what is the optimal hypothesis? Those, what kind of training session should we have? Maybe how length should have the training session? How many blocks of training in altitude condition or hypoxia condition should the people do? Especially focus on sarcopenia, no? That is the part that I'm more interested in, no? If possible. Do you have any hypotheses? Because I'm sure you are working at this moment on.
Thank you very much for your questions. This is a very, very interesting question, and there are too many things to investigate. Anyway, the first question I think is better the moderate hypoxia to severe hypoxia. So this is important. This is important. Has a partial pressure of 15% or 10%. Not too much in order to cause protein synthesis. This is important. Another thing is the objective we try to get is if we look for a hypertrophy, so we try to reduce the recovery. So this is important because there are different studies that the recovery is very important to cause adaptation in the muscle. So not too long recovery, more than 2 minutes is not very interesting. So I try to find a hypertrophy training in moderate hypoxia and with recovery less than 2 minutes. But other question is what kind of exercise better? Whole body vibration is training in the altitude, natural altitude, training in the normal body hypoxia. This is a big question, but we have a logistic problem in natural altitude because not everybody is like you that work in Granada, that's the mountain close to your lab. So the people who want to train in altitude normally use the chambers or normal body hypoxia. So this is more natural in the altitude, but it's difficult logistic. So there are too many topics. And this is amazing work in the future. But I think there are some points you have to, I recommend it for the audience. Thank you very much, Belén. Any question? Any more question? Okay, Anton.
Yes, may I?
Thank you.
I'm interested in your FAT results. So you have used interval training.
Yeah.
And moderate 10 to 15% of fraction of oxygen inhalation. And during this interval training, you find that body fat decreases. So when do you think this body fat is consumed so much, during exercise or after it?
No, above all, thank you for your question. Above all, in the study with obese woman, the calories or the benefits got after exercise, because we thought that the metabolic rate increased with this kind of training. Above all, with the training and hypoxia, so the metabolic rate increase, and this cause the decrease or reduction in fat body.
Mm-hmm. So do you have any possibility to measure heart rate, oxygen consumption, whatever, during sleeping or during period of resting to found?
Yeah. In our lab, it's not possible, because we are working with a chambers, so it's with a generator, and this is not very comfortable to people to sleep at night. So unfortunately, we don't have a house, a hypoxic house, or like in Innsbruck or in Slovenia. So we try to analyze that we can. With the generator, with a chamber, but absolutely, this provides a very, very interesting information.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So, thank you very much for your attention. I think it has been a very interesting and amazing roundtable. And again, thank you the European Congress for Pure Science. I'm sure that the next year we can find together in Glasgow, in Seville, and to have a beer. See you. Bye-bye. Thank you very much.